that everything went dark right away, but I still had an observing self. You know, it wasn't an ego, I don't think. It was just observing consciousness. Things were dark, but I was just watching this. I wasn't the least bit worried. And then I started moving away from my body. When I had my first near-death experience, I mean, I was living a pretty standard life for a suburban kid in San Francisco area, basically. And, you know, skiing on the Squaw Valley Mountain, a really well-known ski resort outside Lake Tahoe. And it took a very bad fall and fractured my spine and on impact. And what I remember is that everything went dark right away, but I still had an observing self. You know, it wasn't an ego, I don't think. It was just observing consciousness. Things were dark, but I was just watching this. I wasn't the least bit worried. And then I started moving away from my body. I could see my body on the ski slopes. Things started to lighten up at that point. I had the light came back on, if you will. I could see the ski area, Lake Tahoe. Then, you know, Colorado Rockies, continental US, and I was moving quickly away, enamored by the whole experience. You know, no pain, like I said. And then as I was taken up in the beauty of it all, I was watching a life review that was of my life up to the first 17 years of my life that was being played back to me really in the background. I mean, I was kind of, you know, there's multiple things happening, but I was enjoying looking at the galaxy, just at peace, really, like I said, enthralled. And then I noticed this whole life review was going on, and my attention focused on that. And I was like, wow, this is my whole life in detail, and focusing on how my actions in particular influenced other people. So it was a real lesson in karma, and not a pleasant lesson either, because the things that really stuck out was, you know, the times when I was unkind or selfish or mean or what have you. And I learned that everything matters. As I was going through that, at some point, once again, all this stuff happened simultaneously. I then found myself in this tunnel of sorts, and in the distance I could see a light. And at first the light didn't mean a whole lot to me, but then as I got closer to the light, it got, you know, not that much closer, I was still pretty far. I realized, oh boy, I'm dying. And then I had a whole nother download of realizations, which is I've been here before. And not just once or twice, like I'm thinking hundreds, maybe thousands of times. So it's very familiar to me. And I felt emotion arise within me that expressed, I don't want to die. I didn't complete what I came to this incarnation to do. I don't want to die. At that point, I was pleading with God, if you will, because I grew up Catholic. As I looked at the light, it was clear to me that that's where the power was. And it was a lovely, you know, suasive, if you will, alluring, pulsating light. And I was just seeing a piece of it. By no way would I claim that I saw the whole thing. I could just say, oh my gosh, I'm just getting a sense for this light, and this thing's enormous. And so finally I'm in the light, and I'm stopped in the light, and I'm more blissed out and comfortable in a certain way, but I'm still agitated in another way. Like, I want to go back. I can't leave this life. I've already done 17 years. I don't want to go back and do another childhood. It's like, you know, I was kind of really working it in my mind, and it's in some really specific details about what I did and did not want. So I don't know how long I was up there pleading, but it wasn't that long. And I felt a gentle push on my being, if you will. And I started heading back. At first, I just thought I was being pushed out of the light. And then I realized, oh, wait a minute. Then that light, God, if you will, said, make something of your life. And that was it. And it was a very solemn, direct, clear message, you know, and it kind of shook me up, like, make something of my life. What does that mean? And then I started moving back kind of moving back towards. At that point, I didn't know what I was moving towards, except I had a sense that, oh, I am going back. And I, as I turned my vision away from the light and started looking back to where I thought was Earth, I could see nothing. I mean, I was just gazing into a beautiful galaxy. There was no Earth in sight. But I realized I was being pulled along in some way, guided. There was a more of an energetic feeling of gravitational pull. And I just went with it. And somebody realized, oh, there's some force guiding this. So eventually I could see planet Earth and then, you know, ski area. And I landed in my body. And I remember when I landed in my body, I felt the coldness of the snow, because I was covered in snow on my back. But I had no feeling in my body. And then I screamed one last time. I don't know if it must have been an internal scream. I think it was an internal scream, you know, don't let me be paralyzed. God, don't let me be paralyzed. And then I felt feeling come back into my body from the extremities first, like from my feet and toes and fingers. And they just kind of moved back into the center of my body. I can't remember if it was that way or the other way. Anyway, but it was like moving across my body, like you're under a warm shower, That type of sensation. And I didn't think of, after that, I came, got back in my body. And then I opened my eyes. I was covered in snow. My friend John came up to me, said, wow, that was a wipeout. And I forgot about the experience for a decade.
Really?
Yeah, I just didn't. I mean, I think I remembered in dreams and such. I know I did. I know I remembered it in dreams and went back. In fact, the first few nights afterwards, I was dreaming quite a bit about it. But I didn't, 17-year-old kid, partying and, athlete, I was an athlete. And that was my first, what I would call spiritual experience in a personal way. I mean, there's religious experiences and things like that. I grew up Catholic and, I wouldn't say that I had a particular calling to at that time to, Roman Catholic spirituality in a certain way. I was more like, I liked the goodness, the morals they taught. I mean, that they were being taught, but I didn't have any spiritual experiences per se. That was the first one. I didn't even know what to do with it. In fact, I wouldn't even call it a spiritual experience until over a decade later. I didn't even know I had it until I actually had a second near-death experience in 13 years after. Yeah, it was 1992. I was 30 years old. Yeah. And that was just an ICU experience, blood imbalance, idiopathic thrombocytopenia, kind of a hemophiliac condition. And I went into the ER and they immediately did a blood test, put a fall alert on me. And next thing I know, I wake up and I'm on top of a ceiling somewhere. I know it's an ICU. Once again, I am this observing consciousness, whatever, with no connection to any, to me or to anyone. I'm just roaming around the ceiling of the ICU, Kaiser Oakland Hospital, and no identity until the nurses are talking about the various patients. And they mention this guy in bed three, who's 30 years old, super healthy, no known history. We don't know what he's doing here. And we don't know how he got here. The doctor's coming in a little bit later to check him out, the expert from UCSF, that's the medical center. And I'm just watching. I think at some point I just move myself because I can move myself, my consciousness. I look over at that body. And I go, oh my gosh, that's me, but that didn't really catch my attention for very long either. Like, I just kind of remember saying, okay, that's me. But then I went around roving because I was much more curious about being on the 10th floor of in the ICU of Kaiser. I mean, I just remember moving down the halls and just kind of checking things out. And that was it. The doctor came in. That's one other thing. This was interesting. So when the doctor came in, the hematologist, he approached me. He approached my physical body. He tapped on my hand and said, Mr. Peters. And I remember that getting my attention, but I didn't feel it. I was above my body and I was looking down at the top of his head and at my body. And then I had this question. Well, do I answer him? Do I not answer him? What if I do answer him? What will happen? And I thought to myself, well, I'll just answer him and see what happens. And so I just said, yeah. So I was very slow. Yes. And as I said yes, I started filling in my body energetically. It was a similar experience to being on that ski slope, you know, where all of a sudden the energy moved across my body. And then I opened my eyes and then my whole perception, my perception field changed in the sense that now I was looking up at the doctor as opposed to looking on top of his, him from on top and seeing his crown. And that was that, you know, and then we had a conversation. So those are two early experiences of that really awakened me to these experiences of being out of body, having a sense of self and consciousness that exists independent of the physical body, and a whole host of other phenomena as you've heard already. So now to fast forward to the subject of my book and my research on the shared death experience. Well, when I went to work in hospice, I started having these experiences. And that is, someone is dying and I would pop out of my body and I would be with them. This happened a few times, but one in particular, I actually, it was what I call my gateway experience into my own shared death experience. I'm at the bedside of this gentleman, Ron, we'll call him, and the book is referred to as Ron, and he's dying. But he's unresponsive. So he's been in what we call, you know, unresponsive, semi-comatose state. So, but I was always reading to him stories. He loved these Jack London adventure stories. And so I would read to him these stories on a regular basis. And on this afternoon, I was reading to him. And once again, to be really clear, he was just almost like sleeping on the bed and looked to be at peace. And I found myself suspended above my body, looking down at my body. I was still reading. I didn't stop reading. And I could see myself reading. And I looked over at Ron in his bed and he was prone, no changes. But then I looked to my right and there's Ron. And Ron's got a big face. Now, it's not Ron's full body. He's got his big face. His eyes are open. He's smiling. He's blissed out, as if to say to me, hey, you know, check this out, William, check this out. So I feel like he kind of invited me there in a certain way. I can't explain how that happens. But this is kind of one of the shared death phenomena where it's called the co-experienced out of body. Now, for your viewers, listeners who are familiar with the near-death experience, the out of body experience, OBE, is very well known and studied. In the shared death experience, it happens as well, but it's typically a co-experienced. In other words, you're typically with the dying or, And when I distinguish out of body experiences from being in other heavenly realms or visionary realms. So this is the OBE in my definition happens right in the human realm, typically in the room or nearby where the dying exists, or where they exist and where they last existed, I guess is the way to say it. And then, but when you go beyond that into another realm, that then becomes visionary heavenly realms. And yeah, so I hope that's a good introduction. I should say the definition of the shared death experience is this. Somebody dies and a loved one, caregiver, or bystander reports that they feel like they shared in the transition from this human existence into a benevolent afterlife with the dying. So they feel like they witness in this journey with the dying. And that's a dominant motif, is that there's a journey going on. There's the spirit, soul, consciousness, however you want to call it, of the dying begins this journey out of the physical body and begins moving into another dimension. And the shared death experiencer is able to participate in that, observe it, and see a lot of the phenomena that the presumably they're experiencing. And the phenomena are almost identical to the near-death experience, except the perception is from a different angle.
I've been able to partner with Mindvalley to present you guys free masterclasses between 60 and 90 minutes covering mind, body, soul, relationships, and conscious entrepreneurship, taught by spiritual masters, yogis, spiritual thought leaders, and best-selling authors. Just head over to nextlevelsoul.com/free. To watch the entire interview of this near-death experience, click on the video below, and don't forget to subscribe.